hello and welcome to the interview on France 24. Today our guest is Martin Griffiths, the UN Special Envoy for Yemen, the man trying to put an end to the war and ultimately to bring peace back to Yemen. Martin Griffiths, you've been negotiating here in Sweden with the Yemeni government and the Houthis. How would you describe the outcome of these talks?
Surprisingly good. Getting here was already something. And it wasn't totally clear to me what we would be able to achieve because the two sides have not sat down opposite each other to negotiate any agreements for over 2 years, during which time they've been fighting. So you start with very limited ambitions, and we ended up making some very real agreements.
So are you satisfied with the outcome?
Yes, I am. I think it's a tricky thing to say, isn't it? But I am actually satisfied with that because I think it's a really good start. And I think it's the agreements that we have made this week are very tangible, they're very real, they'll all be published, they'll all be available for people to see. They all have timelines and we'll be able to see whether what's been promised here will actually deliver.
Is this the beginning of the end of one of the worst conflicts of this century, as the UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres put it?
Hope so. I think it'd be great if it was. As much as anything else, what was interesting about the discussions this week was the fact that it was very easy towards the concluding days for the two parties to agree to come back together again, and quite soon, probably in about 5 or 6 weeks. And that's very, very soon. I mean, that's over the horizon.
What are the main obstacles you had to overcome during these talks?
Confidence was the first thing. And both delegations had not negotiated with each other before. And both delegations hadn't negotiated as a team, each one, before. So we had to work with them to allow them to relax and to feel at ease with the things that they were talking about. Slowly to start meeting each other at the very informal level with our help, with the United Nations help, and slowly to focus on actually tangible things that they could make agreements on and move away from rhetoric, condemnation, criticism towards cooperation and compromise.
Can you tell us about your methods? How have you been working with both delegations, the Houthis and the Yemeni government, during these talks here in Sweden?
I believe very strongly, and I think this is what we saw here this last week, is that mediation, which is what we're trying to do here, is not the act of one person, it's the act of a team of people. And I had a lot of very, very effective colleagues here. We were about up to 20 people from the United Nations. In addition, we had a whole range of diplomats accredited to Yemen, so they knew Yemen, ambassadors to Yemen, all of whom were available, more or less at our request, to go and make messages and points to the different parties. So that was huge, hugely valuable. And of course, we kept in touch with people in capitals. I mean, today we had the British Foreign Secretary coming here overnight to meet the parties, and of course, the Secretary General. It couldn't get better than that. And finally, Sweden. Sweden was terrific, and the government of Sweden, the foreign minister who was here more than once, they organized this impeccably and allowed us, the United Nations, to run it in whichever way we really wanted to.
You mentioned the ambassadors from the different countries that were here. Did the Iranian and Saudi ambassadors try to influence these talks, knowing that they are having a proxy war in Yemen?
The ambassadors who came here are chosen according to their accreditation to the government of Yemen. If you're an ambassador accredited to the government of Yemen, you're invited to be part of the group. It's called the G19, Group of 19 Ambassadors. Iran is not accredited to the government of Yemen, so they were not a member of that group. Saudi Arabia is, so their ambassador was here. I think what I found quite striking was that all those ambassadors, the permanent members of the Security Council among them, a range of Europeans, Sweden, of course, France and others, were united in trying to send cogent messages to the parties to say, we need you to work hard to achieve tangible progress. There were no divisions between members of the diplomatic community.
Some people we met here told us they were members of foreign governments lurking in the shadows. What could you say to us about that?
For a UN process, we have to do two things. We have to take into account the interests of the international community for stability and peace, and we have to do that within the context of putting Yemenis first, and then making sure that it is Yemenis who make free decisions about the future of their country and resolution of their conflict. So we have to do both.
Do you believe that Jamal Khashoggi's murder changed things for Yemen?
I don't know. What happened to Mr. Khashoggi, a terrible thing, is not my issue. My issue is trying to find peace in Yemen. I haven't experienced difficulties with any governments, so I don't feel any pressure. What I feel is, however, that I need to be honest to both parties, I need to respect both parties, and I need to not take sides, and I need to not judge performance, because my job is to find agreement, not judge difference. That's not always easy.
I understand. Regarding the details of the different agreements that were reached, what can you tell us about Hodeidah? That was the most urgent issue, ensuring that humanitarian aid gets there.
The agreement on Hodeidah, I think the parties here should be really proud of this, because it's a humanitarian agreement in the sense that what we've agreed around this table is that both forces will disengage, withdraw from the city and port to allow the humanitarian supplies coming in through the port to go through on the road from Hodeidah to Sana'a that will now become reopened to humanitarian traffic and other commercial traffic. It's closed at the moment because of the war, and get through to the people of Yemen and hopefully help them to avoid famine. And the second thing it does, because the United Nations will have a lead role in the port, and the World Food Programme is already today planning what that means, what experts can they bring in, what improvements can they make in the port to speed up the throughput of supplies. I think it's good news for the humanitarian programme, but it's more than that. Because what Hodeidah agreement will produce, I believe, is a United Nations monitoring mission which will have to deploy within days, within the next couple of weeks, to register compliance to those agreements. It will be a serious mission. It will be one that reports to the Secretary General. That's not happened before in Yemen. And you know, when they talk about Yemen as a forgotten war, well, this is certainly not part of a forgotten war. This is a serious international engagement on Yemen. It's not happened before.
What about ties?
Ties? The parties agreed to form a committee, which sounds pretty unglamorous, doesn't it? But it's the two parties with the United Nations in it. And it should meet very, very quickly, you know, it's formed, so that we can look at a couple of things. We can look at the opening of humanitarian corridors between the lines in Taiz. The front lines in Taiz are fairly static. So we want to open the routes between, so that people can go from one side of the city to the other, and of course supplies as well. We want to do that quickly. And then we want to see if on the basis of doing some things together, that we can then perhaps look at ceasefires, local ceasefires, and finally demining. There's a huge demining requirement in Taiz, as elsewhere. But both parties made a big deal about that here. And the UN, of course, has its agencies that can help on that. So the answer for Taiz is, it may not happen tomorrow, but I think we've got a process that will hopefully give to Taiz what we hope to be giving to Hodeidah.
And during this week of talks here in Sweden, there was a lot of confusion about the situation regarding the reopening of Sana'a's airport. Mm. What can you tell us about that? In the end, there was no agreement reached for now.
But what I'd like to see is that we'll continue negotiating that. We won't stop just because we're leaving Sweden. So that hopefully we'll get that airport open soon. Because for the people of Sana'a to be able to travel in and out around their country and beyond is an extraordinary signal that something different is happening in Yemen, as well as actually good for the families and the injured and returning students. So opening Sana'a Airport is in fact an extraordinarily important issue, and we are disappointed we almost got there here, but I hope we can get there in the next week or so.
And do you have any guarantees that both sides are going to keep their word?
I think that the focus, the emphasis of this these agreements are that they're tangible, that therefore they're verifiable, and that we will have a process, because we will meet again in late January, ideally, and we will monitor the compliance and the implementation of these promises that have been made grandly around this table. So, as many people say, when you go through a week like this, a negotiation, you come out of it thinking, that's wonderful, you then immediately realize that the hard work actually begins tomorrow.
So what could be the next steps in the peace process?
What I hope we can address when we meet again are the fundamental issues about how to resolve the conflict. We've set this out for months, in fact, in the sort of elements of a final settlement to resolve the conflict. I hope next time we start on that journey and go beyond humanitarian agreements.
So the next journey will be about resolving the political issues, like the power sharing deals?
It's about that. It's a package. It's partly power sharing and government of unity. It's partly about returning, as we say, returning to the state, the monopoly of force. All these militias that exist in Yemen will need to hand over their weapons and return to the state, that government that I've described, its control, its monopoly over the use of force. That's a big deal in Yemen. But that's what we need to do. And we kind of know where we need to go to on that, but we need to address it with the parties.
Thank you very much, Martin Griffith. Thank you for being with us on France 24.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.